Chapter 4. Interrupting a live theater performance was not an easy task. While my stomach revolted over finding another dead body and having it physically leaning against me in the dark, I made use of my extensive grasp on the English language to delicately inform the actors we needed to stop the show. As Lear emphatically cursed the weather surrounding him, I'd been forced to shout over him from a few feet off center stage. First came the boos and sounds of people hushing my disturbance. Then the actor portraying Lear turned to me in full character, questioning if I were the impetuous and virulent storm about to hit the stage. Thankfully, once the lighting director moved the spotlight to my seat, the entire troupe could see I was serious about someone needing medical attention. Miriam assumed control of the stage and directed all the guests to quietly and orderly file into the main lobby. Nana D volunteered to call 911 as I kept Gwendolyn's family from rushing up to check on her. I knew the woman had passed away, and while I hadn't truly given credence to her suspicions about someone in her family trying to kill her, it was important to prevent what could be a crime scene from contamination. I'd learned that tenet many times over in the past from our county sheriff. Eustacia moaned loudly and turned to Lindsay for comfort. Millard, her brother, stepped to the side aisle to provide some space, but I was too focused on Ophelia's daughters to listen to his conversation. A tear-stained Jennifer breathed in and out in an almost panicked mode, but soon gained control of her composure. Ophelia kept looking toward two of her children to see how they were reacting, but she didn't appear to be shocked or devastated by her mother's passing. Dana was still backstage and probably hadn't known who'd fallen ill or what stopped the performance. "The ambulance is on its way," Nana D said in a soothing but despondent voice. "My poor friend Gwenny, she wasn't feeling well earlier, but I didn't know it was so serious." I wrapped my arms around my grandmother, who'd leaned against me for comfort. She did have a little spell out in the lobby earlier. I'm wondering if she had a heart attack or a stroke. Maggie stood closer to the stage, tilting her head in a way I knew she was telling me everything would be okay. I always could read her expressions as though I were inside her mind too. Connor arrived within a few seconds, desperate to take control of the situation. As the head of the Braxton campus security office, he'd be the first on the scene, even if he hadn't been on a date with Maggie. After checking Gwendolyn's pulse, Connor pulled Nana D and me aside.
"She's definitely gone. I'm so sorry for her family," he said with sorrow while resting a hand on Nana D's shoulder.
"Connor, you need to check for evidence right away," whispered Nana D while tugging on his sport coat. "Gwenny told me someone was trying to hurt her in the last few weeks. She knew something was wrong. We should have done something sooner about it."
"Nana D, I'm sure the coroner will check for any sign of something unnatural happening." I didn't want to stir the pot when we were already in an awkward state. Connor's gaze opened wide.
"Are you saying you think someone tried to kill her today, Mrs. Denby?"
He looked at me for confirmation, but I shrugged my shoulders. I was distracted first by everything going on, then by Arthur's wide grin while talking on his cell phone near the stage steps.